I'm here in Melbourne for TEDx, a city that thrives on innovation and ideas. So I heard about the work being done by Melbourne University around greening roofs, greening buildings, and I was really fascinated to hear about that work. It's just a wonderful solution to so many of the issues we're faced with. So how do you describe what you do to someone who doesn't know?
Using plants to make cities better places to live, basically. So a lot of science underpinning that, yeah. Getting the plant to tolerate the conditions and function as well as it can, but ultimately it's just about putting more plants in.
Yeah. So we're providing the evidence for local government, state government, to change their policies, change their planning schemes to encourage more greenery in the cities.
That touches on a really key point, doesn't it? Because by 2050, 75% of us will live in cities. Are you seeing more demand for what you do then?
Yeah, it's increasing. It seems like every development application now has got a green roof or a green wall on them.
And I think our research, you know, the last 10 years, it's reduced risk. So people don't now look at green roofs, green walls and go, oh, could we do it? They go, yes, we can. We know how, so let's just do it.
What do you think the main driver is for people to want to install something?
Yeah, it really depends on who you're talking to. So if we're talking to the water authorities, it's about preventing flooding, which will increase under climate change scenarios. Whereas if we're talking to an employer, if their employees will look at a green roof, you know, they're innately attracted to that, and we've shown that they'll be more productive and they have better attention spans. So we can get benefits for the employer that way. Yeah. So it's about talking to what their drivers are.
And what's your main driver?
Why
do it? Beauty?
Yep, transforming cities.
Yeah.
What have you been up to lately, Tim?
I've been in Africa recently, climbing Mount Kenya, looking at the melting glaciers, trying to show climate change through using a proxy of the glacial melt. Took a group of World Bank people up there, senior executive of World Bank. And, you know, it was interesting because they work in the area of climate change communication, but showing a melting glacier and then being able to attribute that to what we are doing was still a very emotional experience for them. They were really pretty affected by it. We tried to capture some of that on camera. So how do you get your work out there to make it accessible to people?
It's about translation and easy to read guidelines. So one example is the Growing Green Guide, which was a best practice guideline to green roofs, walls and facades for Melbourne, but has been translated and used internationally as a best practice guide. So it's just really easy, species lists, how to, nothing complicated, and the science isn't explicit, it's just inherent in what we recommend people do.
So you're offering solutions. This is the other big picture piece that I like, is that you're saying, okay, well, if you're concerned about biodiversity loss and climate change and toxic shock of freshwater to marine ecosystems near cities.
Yeah, so some of those big impacts of climate change which be felt in our cities are that increased flooding and the increased heat, and the green infrastructure makes a big difference to that. And occasionally it's pretty. Well, no, more than occasionally. The other thing we do is we're teaching. So we're teaching students, and then those graduates, they're getting jobs now. They're getting jobs in local government and state government, in private practice.
Yeah.
They now understand the benefits of green infrastructure and how to implement it. And that's moving out beyond the university to the wider world. So Tim, you went back to university while you were having this successful career. Why did you do that?
I found I was dealing with lawyers a lot of the time, and lawyers were the ones who were being tasked with trying to decide who did what and who was responsible for what in the context of cleaning up the planet. So I found if you don't have the background and the academic rigour, you can't have a proper dialogue with people.
You know, more and more what we do, we've got to talk to different audiences about what we're passionate about and what we want to change. And if you don't know the language, like you're saying, you can't have those conversations.
Have that dialogue.
So were you able to fit your expeditions in between semesters? Or how did you juggle that?
I had a very flexible supervisor. And it's a hell of an excuse.
You
say,
don't we?
You know, his essay's late, where is he? And you go, don't ask,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Yeah, really I would have done it, but I got frostbite. I couldn't type the. Well, thanks for the time to meet up, guys. It's just been fascinating to hear what you're doing.
Yeah, great to catch up.
Yeah, thanks. It was really interesting having a chat.